Shaun Gregson here with Luis Scott-Vargas. We've got more Rise of Eldrazi spoilers today. I even have a list this time, so I know the names.
Some of us need a cheat sheet. Some of us.
Oh, really, then? What's the first guy we're talking about?
All is dust.
God damn.
All right. Anyway.
All is dust.
Pretty exciting card. I think it's like a lot of people like Wrath of God.
It's a Crow's
like,
Vengeance.
Pretty much.
Right. It gets everything. There's not much it doesn't get. I mean, it's obviously it doesn't get Eldrazi. I mean, that's like the whole point, right? It doesn't get lands, unless they activate one of their man lands in response.
Yeah, not going to happen.
For 7 mana, it's decent. I mean, I think you have to like preface all the Eldrazi cards with, these are going to be good when Shards rotates out. As long as Putrid Leech and Blightnering in the format, I have a hard time seeing people casting 9 and 10 drops and 7 drops.
You don't see some kind of control deck creeping in the same environment that involves Everflowing Chalice?
Everflowing Chalice and All is Dust is a good combination. I do agree. All is Dust is possible, but like, I don't think we're going to see anyone casting Kozilek, you know, until Blightnering is
not
a card.
We're not talking about those giant fatties today. It's like All is Dust was kind of like the one colorless card where we're like...
Yeah, but like, I mean, what deck are you playing it in that it's good, though? Like, you generally are going to want to have... in order to make it better than, like, Marshall Coup, you need to have guys that survive through it. Otherwise, you should just play Marshall Coup.
Yeah, it was funny. We were joking in the store that Moonlace actually got a little bit of love from this card being printed. Like, we've got stacks upon stacks of that card because it was never good.
Yeah, don't hold your breath.
I expect to see a jump. Eight cents to 24 cents. I guarantee it.
All right, we'll see.
All right, enough about All is Dust. Next on our list, Mr. Doesn't Need a Cheat Sheet. Anything?
Well, I know all the names, but
I don't know. Sir. Gideon.
Gideon Jura, the Planeswalker.
The big man.
Yeah, I mean, he's one of the more expensive cards right now. He's a Planeswalker. He's mythic. He's interesting. I mean, it's kind of a little hard to parse. Like, when a new card comes out, the natural way to see how good it is to compare it to old cards. Like, All is Dust. We compared it to a Chrome's Vengeance. You know, when we see something like Emrakul, well, like, you know, it costs infinite mana, but you can oath it out. Like, we know how to evaluate cards like this. Gideon Jura, the Planeswalker, he's tough. I mean, he does a different thing than all the Planeswalkers we've seen.
So. Yeah, very cool. I mean, it's one of those things where it's like you cast it, and you're not always sure what you're supposed to do with it, especially on an empty board.
Yeah, well, I mean, on an empty board, you just plus 2 it.
Give it some more life points.
Well, yeah, you can't attack immediately. The thing is, he has summoning sickness, so you can't, like, play him and hit him for 6. Otherwise, that card would be pretty exciting.
And that was the first question everyone was asking me. He's like, well, he just comes down, and then he becomes a guy. And like, he still has the same rules. It's like lands becoming guys. It's
yeah,
like,
exactly. But, so Planeswalkers are hard to evaluate initially. Like Sarkhan Vol got a lot of hype, didn't end up being good really at all. Like it almost never got saw like basically no play. Gideon Jura, again hard to evaluate. I'm not overly excited by him, but the fact that he comes in and has 8 loyalty just off the bat is pretty interesting. Like even if they've got like a 2/2 or a 3/3, like you play him, force their guy to attack, next turn kill their guy with his -2, he's still probably got, you know, 3 loyalty or something like that. And then you can start building him up again, and eventually he starts attacking them for 6 or 8 damage.
Yeah, the exciting thing to me about the few Planeswalkers that we've had spoiled is they don't have like a very clear-cut series of how to use them. It's not like positive, 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 and then
right,
an like, ultimate.
There's definitely, you know, Planeswalkers like Elspeth, like play it, make a guy, start jumping guys, eventually ultimate, or Ajani, it's pretty obvious when you, like Goldmane, it's pretty obvious when you want to pump your team. Ajani Vengeance, it's pretty obvious when you want to kill their guy or just tap their land. But you look at, you know, Gideon Jura, you look at, like, even now Jace, the new Sarkhan, like, it's not as obvious what to do with them. You play them and you're like,
I mean, it's obvious considering that his ultimate, quote-unquote, has 0 loyalty. Like, you could technically play it and use it.
Right, I mean, if you had some, like, sort of haste-giving thing or, like, a fling or something, but, you know, that's probably not going to happen too often.
Well, I mean, it's a new thing for Planeswalkers that you can use their last ability and have it be something very different than...
The old Planeswalkers were, yeah, you'd play them, build up, loyalty. And then they started experimenting with, like, you know, the different where the ultimates you can use immediately. I mean, Gideon's kind of cool. You have him play, you Wrath, and then you attack with him. Like, that's the idea, right?
Yeah, plenty of talk about him. Real quickly, a card that I thought was interesting to talk about was Guard Duty. Like, kind of a pacifism effect, kind of like on the Defender theme of the set.
Yeah, I mean, clearly, like, it's worse than pacifism because they can still block with it. And also making their guy defender isn't always that good when they've got, like, the guy who does damage for each defender and stuff like that.
That's what I'm saying. Like, I like the versatility of this card is maybe you're going to start casting on your guy at some point in limited. Like,
yeah, that could happen. It seems unlikely, but...
Yeah. I'm excited by it. I think it's going to be... It's a good...
You get excited easily.
It's a good play on the pacifism effect. I mean, we talk about so many cards that are good and limited, but
well,
it's so hard to just reprint them.
They always remake the pacifism effect, and they always do a pretty good job. I mean, there's definitely
this
distinct,
is just par for the course for you then, nothing new.
It's, you know, the limited pacifism. Like, the only one that I can remember jumping, or the only two that I can remember jumping into Constructed are, like, Oblivion Ring and Face Fighters. Both those have seen heavy playing Constructed, so this one is not going to.
All right, well, good and limited. Near-death experience, exciting card.
Yeah, well, I mean, the exciting card they couldn't make while Mana Burn was all around.
Yeah, it was the first thing when they abolished it in M10 was like, there's so much more design space now, where you can make so many more cards that have to do with
your
life total.
Reverse the Sands is no longer good. Man, that was like one of my favorite cards. I won so many drafts with that card.
I can tell. It's like 6 months ago coming back and talking to me. It's like the exact same thing. Come on, Near-Death Experience has got to be a cool card, right?
I mean, oh, it is, but like one thing, you have to be at one at the end of their turn. Like, you have to be at one at the beginning of your upkeep. So you can't, like, you know, they can't pass the turn with you at four. You untap and bolt yourself. Like, you have to do it at the end of their turn, which makes it a little bit more difficult to use because you can't, like, wait to untap and then have, like, you know, bolt plus counters and stuff like that. He's good with, like, or it's good with, like, pay things you can pay life to, but there's not a whole lot of that right now.
I think it leaves a lot of room for players to come up with those kind of interactions. I mean,
bargain plus near-death experience?
Huh. Not bad. Not bad. Yeah, we'll see that a lot somewhere.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's just a cool design card. I think it's...
All the alternate win cards are cool, and they don't really make them playable for a reason, because if they're too good, they'd be, you know, you just play it and win. Like, these are definitely a little more difficult to get to use, but...
Any card that says win the game on it.
Well, yeah, obviously. That's cool, right? I mean,
it can't be easy. Yada, yada, yada. Same thing.
Test of Endurance. Some are Test of Endurance, some are Mortal Kombat, you know? Mortal Kombat. Such a good name, such a bad card.
Very important.
Anyway, what do we got next?
Kargan Dragonlord.
Figure of Destiny.
Pretty much.
Yeah, it's actually pretty funny how much it mirrors it with at 2 mana, you get a 2/2, you know? At you spend 4 more mana, you get a 4/4. And then you spend just another 4 more mana and you get a 8/8 trample.
Yeah, not at all coincidentally the one I like the most of the level up creatures so far. I definitely looked at this guy.
Well, it's
also
the best one so far.
Right, exactly. I kind of looked at it and was like, okay, I can live with that. I can play that card.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be great in cube.
Ooh, I'm excited already. Yeah, yeah. It's big fire-breathing guy, starts off already at the hill drag
cost. I imagine that this guy's going to hit pretty hard. Lightning Bolt's pretty good against him, as like all the sorcery, you know, like, level up, okay, level up, okay, level up, okay, bolted. Like, I think that makes it a lot less frustrating, because I remember Figure of Destiny, sometimes, like, they would have 3 mana up to level up to a 4/4, and they would just pass, and, like, I'm playing Fairies, have my Agony Warp in hand, and I can't cast it, and they just keep their mana up, and just waste my turn, well, and theirs, but they're attacking me, so. It was definitely, making it a sorcery, I think, was what they needed to do for power level. He's still going to be quite good, though.
Well, agreed. Moving on, we've got Realms Uncharted.
The new Gifts Ungiven that isn't quite there. I'm going to go disagree with a lot of people. I don't see why this card is so insane. Like, obviously with Life and Alone, it's interesting, but at this point, if you can play Life and Alone, you can cast Gifts Ungiven for one more mana. And like, so I was like, blue-green Tron, Realms Uncharted, you get a bunch of Tron lands and like an Academy Ruins. And then if you have Life and Alone, you cast it. I'm like, or you can cast Gifts, get 3 Tron pieces and a Life and Alone. Like...
I the same thing. People are like, "Oh, it's for lands." It's like, well, isn't Gifts for Ungiven for lands too? Like, isn't this the same
thing,
spell?
Like, people, you know, want to play it in 43 lands, but I mean, Intuition, I think, is just better in that deck. So, it's an interesting card. I wouldn't be surprised to see play in Type 2 because it's. I mean, if Divination is seeing play, this card at an instant speed, green and 2, draw 2 cards at the very worst. I mean, they're both lands, but you get a little bit of choice in the matter. That's interesting. I think that's worth, you know, looking at.
Card selection as well. You're pulling some more lands out of your deck. It definitely seems like it has...
If their plan is to Blightning you, casting spells to let you draw cards is good. And if you want to keep mana up for counter spells, casting instants is good. So there might be a deck that wants all that. I mean, there's already people playing a deck that has a lot of lands in it. So we'll see how that goes.
Little overhyped according to LSP. That's like the big news for me.
Yeah.
All right. And last but not least, we have Sarkhan the Mad. We have the last Planeswalker.
Yeah, the Dark Confidant like that hits himself. Can't go up in loyalty. I again don't see the use of this guy that much. Like, not being able to go up in loyalty is rough because one of the things about Planeswalkers is every turn a Planeswalker's in play, you know, your opponent starts to lose more and more. That's not necessarily true with Sarkhan. Once he's at like 2 or 3 loyalty, like if you use his flip ability, he just kills himself a lot of the time. And his turn their guy into a dragon ability or turn your guy into a dragon ability is kind of eh.
I definitely looked at this card and was kind of like, well, sorcery speed draw card, like, not all that exciting. Like, sorcery speed make my guy a dragon, like...
Or kill their guy and give them a dragon, which is probably
not good. Either.
Like, the thing is, what he's doing is just overall, it seems not, it doesn't seem like any of his abilities are quite good enough. So in limited, he seems pretty good, just like every planeswalker pretty much ever. But overall, Sarkhan, I think, is going to go the way of the other Sarkhan. But we'll see. I mean, could play him in your dragon deck, throw your Kargan Dragonlord at them.
It could be exciting. I don't know. I don't really see this guy going anywhere. So,
a lot of new cards, kind of mixed reviews. We'll see. I mean, the set's going to be pretty sweet, but I guess we'll have to wait to see all of the cards.
Until then, thanks for tuning in.
Yeah.
Cut. Thank you. Just out of the water. It's going to be tight. No, it's going to be tight.
Good one.